previous video we installed the inlet, the carburetor. We adjusted this fuel switch so that it was on that angle there, coming out with the clear hose to be able to see whether or not there's fuel going to the carburetor. The design hasn't worked properly because, as you can see there, there's an air bubble going from there to there. So what I'll have to do is shorten this hose so that it comes down here. We put in the timing plug, see-through timing plug, and did the timing, backed these off, and turned this adjustment plate so that there were two dots appearing in the window there. That work didn't make any difference to the bike. We then installed two new iridium NGK spark plugs and the bike ran fine. So it's just a matter of now trying to start it up. If it starts right up, then it's fixed. If we establish that it's fixed, then I start putting the bike back together. There was one strange thing that happened yesterday. I got it all set up to do the timing. I got the timing light, and just as I picked up the timing light and aimed it at the the window there for the timing, the bike cut out. And then I came around here and I pushed this starter switch and nothing happened for about 30 seconds to a minute. Of course it wasn't on film, and surely enough, when I turned the camera on, pushed the button and it started up, so it was a bit strange. I think that's fixed. Okay, so that was a cold start. It backfired a little bit, but I used a lot of choke. And once it warmed up, I let the choke off, and it seems to be running well. Okay, so that's good news for me. Bike's fixed. The fix was definitely all work. All work done. Okay, so we'll take out the spark plugs and see what we got. Okay, that's really badly fouled up. There's the rear cylinder spark plug there. It's also fouled up, so I think it could be the jet sizes. This engine does have good compression of around about 150 psi. The air fuel mixture is 1¾ turns out with the I think it's the idle screw mixture. Looking through the comments, somebody said that he thought that the baffles had been taken out of the bike. That could be right, I'm not sure. It's loud, but it's not that loud. And another comment here, check your jetting. A lot of people use a 185 main jet and a 45 secondary jet. Okay, so looking inside the exhaust tips, I don't think that the baffles have been taken out. You can see there that everything is still intact and nothing's been removed. Same with the other one. But you know, maybe if I take it out on the road, then the spark plugs will have less oil on them. Also, I've got a feeling that this bike may have been, the carburetor may have been set up for running rich just during the break-in process, and the work after that, you know, changing the jets and the rest of it was never done. But that had nothing to do with the original problem, which was a huge amount of backfiring and a gradual breakdown and no performance. Okay, so let's put it back together, do a test run, get it registered, and you know, just build on the work that's already been done. The video when I fixed the bike and I went up the driveway and back, and I couldn't fire it up. The next video I did realise that this connection here was not done up. Okay, that was open. There were still issues when I reconnected it and started the bike, but after fixing the bike the first time, the second video, this was undone and I couldn't start it. I haven't had an opportunity to get longer screws, so I'm not going to put the metal plate on. Just going to put these on like so. These have got a thread in them, so just attach that like that. This is the indicator module. So this is the indicator module. We've got the harness just coming up through there like that. That's the module. And it seems to be time activated. And she sits just down there in that gap there. So a little something like that. This is the CDI ignition module. And just clips together. If you turn it around the right way, and she sits just there. So it came with this static bag, and just for good luck, I'm going to keep it on there and just push the screws through. Yes, so there it is in its static bag. There's just two screws there and there, and that's it. Put the cover on, put a zip tie around the top there. That is your circuit breaker, fuses, the indicator relay. If you want to see good videos on this bike, or the model before it, SYY Energy 7 channel. He owns one of these, he's owned it since new. It's a 19, 89, and he's got all sorts of tricks he uses. He doesn't hot them up or make them look good. It's just work he does to make sure that the bike will keep running. So I recommend those videos. It's a tight fit. I don't know if you can see him or not, but there's a kookaburra just there. Okay, this is an engine brace, ignition switch and horn holder, so I'll attach that now. Yeah, so with this brace, there's just one bolt there, one bolt here, and two there. And there's a metal brace behind the back for the nuts. So this is a non-standard ignition switch holder. You can see it's been sort of knocked up in a garage somewhere. With this one, you've got to put this small screw in first. So what I do with my ignition switch, just to make sure that there's no short circuit, is I've just got this piece of plastic and I put it between the frame and the electrical circuitry there. Okay, so I built this plastic cover, and that covers the whole of the ignition switch there. Okay, so that's it. That's the front of it there, where the weather will be going in. You can see there's just enough room for the wires to get through. It hooks around the back on either side. You might have seen on one of my previous videos where I picked up this ignition spark tester. I'm sort of tossing up whether or not to install it. It doesn't have any sort of lock-on mechanism. If I look in there, there's a very small, tiny little bar sort of running across. I mean, it's so small you can hardly even see it. And the cap doesn't sit on all that well. Now it's going to turn around because of its design, but you can keep it held on by the length of the lead. So I don't know, because I've got to cut my lead and I don't have a spare one. I've decided I'm going to give it a try. I've got my coil in place with the bolt through the frame, and I'll just get the length of the lead. I know that this lead is the same thickness as that diameter inside the connector. I think I can just get these at a auto parts store, but these two leads cost an embarrassing $60. So I hope this goes well. So that's inside your ignition wire. It just looks like a metal lead, silicon around the outside with black around wrapped around that. Okay, so I do not recommend these spark testers. The reason being is that this won't fit into it, and when you cut out a little bit, cut off the top layer, and you get that what looks like a copper core there, or a metal core, it just will not. You've got a sort of a pin, a threaded pin, and it doesn't matter how hard you try, you just can't screw that into there. So that's very bad news for me. I have to source some more cables. I think I'll just get them from a car shop. But yeah, that's got a pin that's been cut down. This actually won't fit with the black outer coating. But you absolutely cannot, you know, no matter how hard you try, you can't thread that onto there. So I'm not sure whether you're supposed to have a different type of lead or what the situation is, but I'll keep trying to install them. I'll just see what sort of lead's supposed to be used with them. Because as I'm breaking down, I can look down and see if I've got spark or not. And I can see if I've got fuel or not, and I can see if my charging system's working or not. It's a battery gauge, LED battery gauge.